Prophecy Club, a nationwide television program, a nationwide radio program. The Prophecy Club also hosts approximately 40 major city meetings per month. Our mission is to inform Christians of current events that confirm Bible prophecy, expose the evil devices of Satan, warn believers what is coming to America, challenge people to stop sinning and turn to Jesus with all their heart, and to provide a platform for Christian speakers to be heard.
It's a bald-faced lie.
Using the positions of power and authority in our own government.
The greatest oil field in the world is at the southwest end of the Dead Sea. He said, son, you must warn this nation.
And now your host for the Prophecy Club, Stan Johnson.
Welcome to the Prophecy Club, where we study and research Bible prophecy. And tonight, we are going to be researching Bible prophecy, and we're going to be researching about how the Bible says that in the last days there will be a world government. Revelation 13, 1, I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon each horn the name written blasphemy. And it's talking about a world government that is formed, I believe, out of ten continents, seven continents divided into ten kingdoms, each kingdom having a leader. And tonight we're going to find out about who those continents are, those leaders, and how it all puts together. The title of tonight's videotape, very much related to Bible prophecy, is Lucifer's Children. Your speaker tonight has studied this particular topic for some 30 years. He's also been an ordained minister for the last 30 days, pastored his own church. And he's researched this in over 300 different books and documents. And I believe he has some real truth to share with us. Will you help me welcome Milan Martin?
Thank you, Stan. I appreciate you inviting me to here today. As Stan said, I've been involved with the ministry and in various forms of the ministry for over 30 years, assistant pastor for a number of years in Texas. Senior pastor for several churches in Oklahoma. So tonight we'll be talking a little bit about how we came to write this book here, Lucifer's Children. I say we because I don't believe I could have ever written this book without the help of my wife. She's my best friend and just prayed for me. And it took a lot of effort to put this book out, and a lot of it was on the part of my wife. So I always try to thank my wife, Reva. So, again, it's good to be with you this evening. This 30-year journey actually started back in about 1967 when I was a young man getting ready to graduate from high school. And during the period of about 2 to 3 years before that time, I had attended almost a dozen funerals, and these were for young men who were friends of mine that had been going off. Of course, you all know that the Vietnam War was going at that time, and they had been drafted. Most of them had been in the Army, and they had gone off to Vietnam, and most of them had come back in pieces many times. And so, as you can imagine, as a young man, this greatly affected me. And my best friend, Mike Mendenhall, a young man from Tulsa, Oklahoma, state champion wrestler, All-American, tremendous young kid, tremendous talent. He came back from 2 weeks. He had been drafted. He's a little older than I was. He had been drafted, gone to Special Forces training, and had come back. This was Halloween weekend, I think, 67, if I remember right. And, of course, me and him were not Christians at that time. We had gone out drinking and doing our carousing. And he was facing going back. He was going to go back for one more week's training as a tunnel rat. I don't know if any of you all are familiar with that term. But they used to train young men in survival techniques. They would actually go down in the tunnels. Underneath Vietnam was riddled with tunnels, miles and miles of tunnels. The life expectancy of a tunnel rat was about 2 weeks. About 5 weeks after that weekend where we had went out, that Halloween weekend, 5 weeks, I believe, 5 to 6 weeks, I attended his funeral. It's a closed casket funeral. There was just bits and pieces of him. Of course, that really bothered me. And here I am facing, you know, I'm about to graduate from high school, facing this whole thing. I know that I'm going to get a draft notice within just days. And so I thought, you know, the Army is not really a place for a guy like me. So I think I'll just go over and join the Air Force. So I went over and joined the Air Force, took the test, passed the test, but they gave me an induction date, and or a date where I could enter, and that date had to be before my induction date if I was to be drafted. So I said, fine, I just took my chances. Well, sure enough, I came home one day from school and my draft notice was sitting on my bed. And lo and behold, my draft induction date was before the date I could leave in Air Force. So I had to run down. If I didn't want to join the Army, and none of us did at that time, most of us didn't, I ran down and joined the Navy, hoping that I would be placed on the East Coast or the West Coast and I'd get some little cushy, you know, position. Lucky me. I ended up right in the mouth of DMZ on a minesweeper, doing rice patrols up and down the rivers of Vietnam in what we call the Brown Water Navy. So you could imagine where I found myself. I was a little shocked. Anybody here ever seen Apocalypse Now? Okay, those little boats in there on that show was MSRs. They were minesweeping river going. And what our job was on those little boats was to do rice patrols. The many women and children would be on these boats, very few men would be on them, and they would go get rice, and a lot of times they would run that rice up the rivers and supply the VC. So our job was to search these little junks or these little boats to look for rice, you know, more than what was normally needed for a family. And so we would do that. We'd stop the little boats. We'd get over on the little junk and look around, search the whole thing, see what was on there. And if there was a little rice, it was fine, but there was quite a bit of rice, then we would take the rice and take it over and show it to a Vietnamese liaison officer that we had on there. This man had been lived in New York City for a period of about 5 years, spoke better English than I did. And we would take the contents of whatever there was we found and take it to this man and show it to him. And if he thought it was too much rice or too much supplies or whatever for a family, he would question him. If he did not like the answers to the questions that he got, we would take the women and children, put them on the boat, and take them back to our little compound. He would further interrogate them from that place, and then if he still did not like the answers to his questions, he would take women and children in the back of the compound, and he would shoot them. Well, thank God I didn't have to actually take part in that aspect of things. But as you can imagine, as a young man, and I don't think I'd even turned 20 yet, this really began to bother me. So up until that time, I had never done any drugs. I don't think there was any drugs on the streets of Oklahoma when I'd left. So all we had ever done was drink and carouse. Like I said, we weren't Christians at that time. I wasn't. So as you can imagine, here I am, a 19-year-old kid from Oklahoma, hardly ever been out of Oklahoma. This really bothered me because it got to the place where every time I took one of those kids and lifted them off their boat and set them down on our MSR, I was pretty sure they might not come back. And most of them just women and kids, and actually most of them were innocent. I found that out later because I found out later as I began to ask around that this man had a quota that he had to meet. I don't know if you all know much about Vietnam, but everything over there operated on a quota. We had a body count quota. Everything operated on a quota. I could go to bed at night and see those kids' face in my dreams. I started doing a meltdown. I started having problems. I'd ask, it bothered me why we were there anyway. I used to ask, I always been one to ask a lot of questions. I said, what are we here for? What are we really doing? How did we get in this mess anyway?
I don't know.
You ask questions. I don't know. Just shoot up and, just shut up, Martin, and shoot. Just shut up and shoot, Martin. That's about all I'd get. Ask questions, just shut up and shoot, Martin. And so the more that went on, and I began to ask around, and I got on drugs, and I was buying drugs from some special forces guys that would supply us. I'd ask them what was going on. They couldn't tell you why we were over there. But I did begin to find out a little bit about the program that we were involved in. I did find out from those guys that the liaison officer that was on our boat was getting a reward, a bounty for ears. When he was killing those kids and innocent women and children, he would get a bounty of approximately $80 for a set of ears. 80 American dollars for a set of ears. Well, you could imagine. That is when I first got my first clue there was something wrong with our government. At first, I thought, Washington can't possibly know what's going on here. These guys are, just a bunch of cowboys out here doing this on their own. If Washington knew what was going on, they'd put a stop to that. But I eventually realized, this was the program. I eventually found out, not then, but later, as I got back home, years later, I found out we were part of something called Operation Phoenix. And as I read up on it later, years later, I found out that we had killed somewhere between 40 and 60,000 children, women, innocent people, and our CIA had paid, approximately $80 for a set of ears. Well, of course, I didn't know all that at that time. But I'd ask around. I'd ask how we got in this mess. Why were we here? Like I said, nobody could give me a straight answer except one young man. This young man was a very intelligent young man. Me and him started doing drugs together and running around a little bit. Extremely intelligent young man. And actually, he had made a lot of money before coming to Vietnam, investing in what he called the military-industrial complex. And I'd ask him, he talked to me about investing and how to make money in what he called Council on Foreign-Related Military-Industrial Complex. I, of course, being a young man from Oklahoma, I didn't understand the vast network it took to build the armaments of warfare. I never heard the term military-industrial complex. Certainly never heard the term Council on Foreign Relations. And I said, well, who is this Council on Foreign Relations and what do they do? How do they run the military-industrial complex? And he said, well, they're a branch of the Illuminati. And I said, the Illuma what? The Illuminati. And I said, well, what's that? And he said, it's a bunch of occultists. I said, cultists. And I said, remind me never to smoke any more of your dope. You're crazier than I am, I just didn't want to believe, and we don't want to believe some of these things. You have to have a love for the truth to believe the truth. You know that? My mind balked at the idea of believing that maybe all of my friends and all the blood, innocent blood spilt by all my friends, and they had died at the hands and on the altar of corporate greed by a bunch of occultists. So I found that hard to believe. Occultists. I said, well, what do you mean they're the Illuminati, an occultist? What's their deal? He said, they're a group of international socialists bound and determined to create in this world and impose upon us all a one world government, a one world financial system, and a one world religion. And I kind of maybe, I took most of what he said and just kind of put it on the shelf. He would show me articles. And in my book here, I give you a couple examples of some of the articles that he showed me about how the Vietnam War had begun. And, you asked this guy a question. He was the only one that could give you an intelligent answer. He knew his stuff. And so I didn't just, discount him altogether. I thought, well, maybe he does know what he's talking about, because any other question I'd ask him, he could give me an intelligent answer. Well, by that time, I had done a total meltdown, though. Here I was, you know, I was doing drugs. I had stopped writing my wife. I got to the place where I didn't care about anything or anybody because of all the things I had been involved with these kids. I kept seeing these kids in my dream. That was really bothering me. And then I asked about the Vietnam War, and he said, you know, we're not really here to win this war. And I said, you know, and I had to agree with him. We were there to fight and to die, but we really were not there to win this war. And he was the first man to tell me, he said, there's a lot of money being made by this war. And those who have brought us here to fight and die are making money off this war. So they're going to drag this thing out as long as they can. And eventually I didn't believe him. But eventually, you know, as time went on, it became obvious to any of us that the kind of restrictions that was placed upon us at that time, I'll tell you folks, we could have won that war in any 30-day period. We'd have won to win it. The problem is the powers that had sent us there did not want that war to end. I promise you, we could have won that war quickly, but that was not in the cards. I continued to do a meltdown, morally, physically, spiritually, and to make a long story short, they eventually discharged me out of the Army, out of the Navy. And, of course, I don't blame them because I had gotten to the place where I was no good for anything or anybody. I was a danger to myself. There was weeks when I was just led around to the bathroom and to the mess hall because I was just a vegetable. I was smoking angel dust. I was doing everything in the world. Anything anybody'd give me, I'd take. I didn't even ask what it was. Anything to deaden that pain. You know, I could still see those kids. It's bothering me. So if you want to know what faces some of the guys that come home, you might not even realize what some of these guys have been through and what the ghosts and stuff that are haunting them. I was discharged out of the military. I had been given a discharge date, and during that discharge, between the time I was to be discharged, they put me in a cell, solitary confinement, bread and water. Seriously, that's what I got, bread and water. And I was there for a period of 40 days, I believe, not all that time in bread and water, but part of that time. But during the last part of that time, when I was in bread and water, solitary confinement, I was sitting there, period about 30 days, you know, I was just about to go crazy. You know, you put a person in solitary confinement, they have a lot of time to think. I sat there and thought about my life and where it's going and how I embarrassed my parents and my wife and how that my life was headed nowhere, going nowhere. You know, I sat there and count the brads on the walls, you know, over and over and over again. I had 3 pet cockroaches I knew, you know, I had them all named. I could tell from across the, you know, room where, which one was, you know, I almost got to the place where I was talking to them. Your mind goes a little crazy when you get a place like that, you know. You have a lot of time to think. And during about the last 10 days that I was in that confinement, one night, one evening, a Marine guard came around the cell block, and I noticed he dropped something on the floor right in front of my cell door, and he kicked it underneath the cell door. And I reached out and grabbed it. I wanted anything to occupy my mind at that point. And I reached out and grabbed that old book, and what it was an old, beat-up, tore-up, marked-up, half-tore-up Good News for Modern Man. Now, see, I wasn't a Christian, never been raised in church. I didn't really know much. Didn't know anything about the Bible. And so I sat there and looked at that thing. The only reason I knew it was a Bible because, you know, it didn't have a black leather cover on it like my grandmother's Bible did. But I sat there and I looked at it and said Genesis and looked back in the back and said Revelation. So I figured, well, this is the Bible. And so not knowing what to do with it, never read the Bible in my life, I did the least logical thing. I turned over into the back of the book and started reading the book of Revelation. And I said, my gosh, and, you know, I was confronted with all these beasts and signs and seals. And I said, phew, what, you know, what is all this? But I wanted something to occupy my mind, and I noticed as I was continuing to read that book that there was a presence in my cell. Begin to just take over. I could just feel it throughout the whole cell, just a presence. Well, I had 10 days left before my discharge date. And I just began to read that Bible. And I started from Genesis, and I went all the way through to the book of Revelations and back and forth. And as I did, I began to realize, especially as I was in the New Testament there and in the Gospels, I began to realize some of those words were just kind of just jumping off the page at me. I mean, the Holy Spirit was working with me and dealing with me. And I began to realize I was starting to understand some of what I was reading there. And about 3 days before my discharge date, the guards would turn the lights out about 10 o'clock. And so the 10 o'clock came around, the guards turned the lights out, and I was laying there on this metal bunk. And I just said, Jesus, I want you to come into my life, and I want you to change my life and make something out of it. You see, I was so miserable. I had embarrassed everybody. I'd embarrassed myself. I deserved to be kicked out of the military, and I had to come to the conclusion that I was. You know, I deserved it. And I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into my life at that point. And I, you know, a lot of people take their salvation by faith, but I didn't have to. I had this feeling that hit the top of my head, and it went all the way down through my body. It's kind of like, you know, when your foot goes to sleep, your leg goes to sleep, and then you feel all those pins and needles as the blood begins to circulate. Boy, that hit me at the top of the head and went the whole way down, boy. And I just sat there for 5-10 minutes just shaking like a leaf. And I didn't know, I couldn't told you theologically what happened to me, but I knew something had happened. Well, the day finally came that they kicked me out, you know, or my discharge date. So they come, opened the cell door, threw some civilian clothes at me, and said, here, put these on. So I put my civilian clothes back on, and they hauled me out to L.A. International Airport. This all happened in Long Beach Naval Base, while it was still there. I'm not sure it's actually still there. So they took me out of L.A. International, you know, dumped me out, said, here's your ticket. Get out of town. Don't ever come back. Well, I was glad to leave, believe me. So went up and got my boarding pass for my flight. And I had about 30, 40 minutes to kill. So I went and roamed over to the magazine section. And, you know, I wasn't real religious. You know, didn't know anything. Just pure born again, not knowing nothing. You know, that's when you're most dangerous to the devil. I don't know if you all know that or not. When you don't know nothing, you don't know anything, you know, you're not religious. You know. And I went up there walked up to the magazine rack, and right, this was like in February of 70. Walked up there, my magazine rack, Time Magazine, across the front, said Jesus Movement, Revival Across the Land. Well, like I said, I wasn't religious. You know, I didn't get religious till after I'd gone to my second, graduated from seminary. I didn't get religious at all. So didn't know to be religious, you know. So I just prayed out loud, Lord, I want that. And there was people standing all around me. They all just started looking around, you know. And I just talking to the Lord out loud. Didn't know any better. Like I said, I wasn't religious. Well, they just look at me. I didn't care. Grabbed that magazine up. Took it up, paid for it, went back out, sat down, waited for the boarding to start. And I read, finally got on the plane, read that magazine over, that article over. I must have read that article a dozen times on my flight back to Oklahoma. Got back to Oklahoma, and within 2 weeks, I was involved with one of three churches in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Sheridan Christian Assembly Center, that was working with the kids on the streets of Tulsa, Oklahoma, in what we call the Jesus Movement. The rest of the churches in Tulsa wouldn't allow those nasty, filthy, dirty kids and those hippies into their church. But these three churches worked together, actually. And I worked through that one church primarily, but the other two I worked with somewhat. And together, those three churches working together, we got not just hundreds, we got thousands of kids off the streets of Tulsa, Oklahoma. Got them off drugs, got them delivered. And So I eventually went to Trinity Bible College in Tulsa, and then eventually I moved to Dallas, Texas to attend a seminary down there. And during that time, I had sold my house in Tulsa. I took that money and started a carpet cleaning company. And I was starting to do real good with my carpet cleaning company. After graduating from seminary, I started working with a small church that was just starting up in Dallas, Texas, and eventually became an unofficial assistant pastor. Didn't get paid for it, but I learned a lot. And so one of my duties there was to run a Bible study out of my home, and I started studying the book of Daniel and began a Bible study out of my home for the pastor. And we, again, studying the book of Daniel. And as I studied that book, I began to realize that there was a lot in the book of Daniel that had to do with world government. And as I prayed, and you know, I'd never heard anything about world government, New World Order, any of this stuff that we're going to talk about here this evening. I'd never heard about any of that in seminary. I learned a lot of good things in seminary, but I hadn't heard anything about world government. Or Bible prophecy. Really, they don't teach you much about Bible prophecy in seminary unless you elect for certain classes. And so as I studied that, I prayed, and I said, Lord, if I'm understanding what I'm reading here about Bible prophecy in the book of Daniel, I said, certainly there is a world movement out there to create a world, one world government. And as I began to pray, this book, The Naked Capitalist, came into my hand within a couple of weeks. Actually, this is the very book, 30-some years ago. And it came into my hand, and I turned over on page 27 of that book, and I began to read about Plato. I discovered the author of this book had said Plato was the foundation upon the New World Order and what was written in this book here. Eventually, and I began to read other books, and eventually this book right here, The New World Order by William T. Steele, came into my hands. And to this day, I still say this is one of the very best books ever written on the subject. He says in this book, he confirmed what I had read over in The Naked Capitalist, and here's what he said. The Atlantean legend seems to set the ideological foundation upon which all the secret societies rest. Whether it is the cooperative commonwealth of the Ten Kings, now remember the Ten Kings, because we're going to be touching on that this evening, the philosophical empire, the New Atlantean League, the New World Order, or the New Atlantis. The meaning is always the same: to establish a so-called enlightened world government. So after reading that, I began to realize, well, you know, I need to study up on Plato, because many of these books that I had read on the New World Order up until that time had mentioned Plato somewhere along the line. And this guy says right here it's the foundation of this ancient plan of secret societies. So as I began to study Plato, I began to realize that Plato was the basis of many things, not just the New World Order, but as you see in this cover here, James Webb's cover, The Occult Underground, you have a depiction of Plato, and all these, this Medusa-headed symbolism here represents all the different isms: Nazism, socialism, communism, fascism. And as Webb teaches here in his book, Plato's philosophies are the very core of much of what all these different isms believe. It's kind of the root of the whole thing. So I began to realize this is something I needed to study. So I began to study along these lines. Now, a very interesting thing happened here to me. I eventually moved to Tulsa, Oklahoma, because I was offered a senior pastor position at Southwest Christian Chapel. And an interesting thing happened to me. This was about this time of year. We had set up a real nice display up in the front of our church. We was on a major thoroughfare there in Tulsa. And so I had my electrician go out, and he set up some lighting, and we planted a big, huge cross. And we put a crown of thorns on it. It was up close to our marquee. And we draped velvet over the whole thing, made it look real nice, and then we had our marquee out there. And as my custom was, I'd always get up about 5 o'clock on Sunday morning and come down to the church, get down to the church about 6 o'clock, and go over my notes and pray before a Sunday morning service, and just, you know, let the Lord speak to him if he wanted to add to it, or just, you know, brush up on my notes, just get before the Lord, get the mind of the Lord. About 6 o'clock in the morning that morning, I pulled in the parking lot and I noticed my cross was gone. You know, the whole thing's gone. I said, well, what in the world's going on here? And so I go open up the church, look around, nothing wrong inside the church. And I just happened to walk out in the back. I figured, well, I'll just go out and look out in the back. And we had a daycare, and we had this real high fence all the way around, and the doors were locked all the time. You know, we always wanted to protect the kids. We didn't want anybody getting in and out of there without supervision. So we had a tremendously high fence. And I opened that back door and looked out there, and there my cross is planted in the back of my church, upside down and backwards. And I said, well, what in the world? Why would somebody go to all that trouble to climb that huge fence, get back here, and do this? How many of you ever had something in your life, just an experience or something happened to you, that was kind of a turning point in your life, but you didn't really realize at that point that that was going to be kind of a turning point? But yet, that instance probably sent you off in a different direction. You see, I would have stayed there at that church, might have still been there at that church today if that hadn't happened. Walked out there, saw that, and I thought to myself, why in the world would somebody want to do that? Well, you know, I'd heard of backward masking. Didn't really realize, you know, didn't really understand it. Didn't understand much about the occult world. I was probably your typical pastor at that time. But the Lord said, I want you to understand, because you're looking at something very significant in the occult world. And I said, okay. And what had happened, and why the people had done that, we had been having Christian concerts for young people in and out of my church, and we've been putting on concerts and working with some other churches too. And I had been told that in Tulsa there was 3 witch covens, and one of them met at a park about 2 miles from our church, a place called Chandler Park up on a great big hill. So, you know, and I didn't take that too seriously, you know, average pastor, yeah, okay. But come to find out, we had gotten about a half a dozen, I think maybe 8 other kids saved in church and out of their cult. And I was being targeted by the leaders of this one cult. But, you know, I had never taken anything serious like that. And then I began to be followed. Even my phone was bugged. Things were happening, strange things were happening. And it kind of got my eyes open. Maybe I better take this seriously. And then when the Lord said that, He said, I want you to study what you just saw right there. You need to understand. And so I did. I began to pray about what that meant. And I found out in the occult world, that is called the polarization principle. Of course, I didn't know much about Gnostic dualism. As I began to study the New World Order, I found out that Gnostic dualism was at the heart of what these people do and say and believe. So I began to study this polarization principle. Now, you might know a little bit about what I'm talking about by the terms of the Hegelian dialectic process, thesis, antithesis, consensus. You know, basically it's, you know, getting people to manipulating people. You create a circumstance, and then you come along and provide your answer for that problem. You see, you provide them with choices, but of course the choices are all theirs. And then as you pick their choice, then you are moved from one point to the next. It's kind of like boiling the old frog in the water. He hardly ever knows he's being boiled, you see. And then as I begin to study the polarization principle and getting into another aspect of that same manipulating process, I begin to understand about power from above and power from below, power from the right, power from the left. And how that we can be traumatized, we can be put in a position of trauma-based control or social engineering by being put in a position where we have pressure placed upon us and we can be traumatized. You see, you fly a plane into World Trade Center, and the same people that a month earlier would have said, you know, don't you touch my constitutional rights. you know, all of a sudden they're screaming for peace and safety. You know, I think I read about something about peace and safety in this Bible right here. Same people that wouldn't let you take away their guns a month earlier are the very same people that want peace and safety and call for the government to protect them. You understand what I'm getting at? And some people even say, hey, I want some relief from this stress, this, you know, I want protection for my wife and my family. We need more government control. Take away my guns, take away my constitutional rights, whatever you got to do, put cameras on every street corner, film everything I do, record everything I say, whatever you have to do to give me some peace. That's the polarization principle that the occult has used on us for hundreds and hundreds of years. So as I began to study this thing, I began to understand that this was definitely an occult practice. I studied Plato, and in conjunction with what I just was describing with you. And here's what I discovered about Plato's writings. Plato wanted to breed a three-tiered section of humanity. He wanted to create a gold, a silver, and a brass or bronze section of humanity. Now, the gold were to be the elite. They were to be the true citizens. They were the ones that could own all the property. They were your doctors, your lawyers, your ministers. They were highly educated and be the ones that control all the corporate functions. They were the elite, highly educated. Even over those was 10 kings or dynasties that had a hereditary set up where they kind of ruled like kings. And they were extra special because they were allowed to control all, they were to be allowed to control all the natural resources. Now what we're talking about here is the dialogues of Plato. And of course, one of his dialogues talked to us about the lost continent of Atlantis. Everybody in here has heard, of course, about the lost continent of Atlantis. And this is what, in Plato's dialogues about the lost continent of Atlantis, this is a structure that he said existed at that time in Atlantis. Now, if I was to take a poll here tonight, and I've done this several times, and usually I ask how many people in here believe that there was a lost continent of Atlantis, and normally I get about half the audience will say, yeah, there may be something to it. And then I ask, you know, how many people don't believe it, and usually you get about a third of the people believe it, about a third of the people don't know that they believe anything about it, or they just haven't studied it, and then you get about a third of the people say, you know, I believe it's all, you know, myth, not a word of truth to it. So that's usually the way it breaks down, and I've done that poll several times. So, and really, though, folks, it really doesn't matter whether it ever existed or whether it doesn't matter, because the truth of the matter is the people who do believe that it existed used this dialogue of Plato and these 10 kings and this structure that I just described to you. They are bound and determined to impose their belief system on us all. So whether it's true, whether it's not, these people think it's true, and they plan on implementing the things that we're going to be getting in here to this evening. Yes, they had an elite. Now, they also had a secondary group, and they Plato wanted to breed people for these functions. The secondary group was the silver class, and they would be a military Rambo-type class bred for that purpose to protect the elite and their private property from the great unwashed masses of the bronze or silver people who would basically just be, they'd be dumbed down, slightly educated basically only to provide the needs for the corporate elite. So the silver class would protect the elite from the great unwashed masses of this basically slave class. And this is the kind of stuff that Plato believed, and this is what he taught. As I read further, I found out that Plato, as a bisexual, had very little regard for the family. And he saw really no need for the family much. So he believed all the women should belong to all the men to all the women, and that the children produced by this should be raised and controlled by the state and put in the function, taught, you know, whatever was needed, whatever their particular talents were, that those talents could be best understood and utilized by the state. And so you can understand where he was going with all this. He wanted to breed people in those three classes, kind of like a three-tiered caste system that you'd kind of be locked into. So Plato had very little regard for the family. He wanted to actually do away with the family. This is a book I highly recommend, The United Nations Global Straitjacket by Joan Vian. And what she talks about in here much is the Hegelian dialectic process, or what I refer to as a plutocracy. And she also talks about how that Christian groups and secular foundations, charitable organizations, are actually becoming in partnership, going into partnership with United Nations under United Nations funding to fulfill much of what the United Nations is trying to implement throughout the earth through its various charters and treaties. Now, George W. Bush is talking much today about giving lots of money into the hands of Christian organizations to be able to help the poor, and most Christians and pastors think that's just a wonderful thing. But folks, I don't know if you know that or not, but George W. Bush's plans actually dovetail in and fulfill much of what his father tried to implement when he was ambassador to the United Nations. And though most Christian pastors don't really realize it, this really fits into their plans. And so we, as Christians, should not be getting into partnership with secular organizations for money. They have all the money in the world, and sometimes we, as Christian groups, feel like we don't have any money or not enough to do what we want to do. And so we're tempted to fall for this. But I assure you, friends, as Christian organizations, churches, we do not need to be getting our money from the world system. You know, we need to be in the world. We don't need to be of it. We don't need our financing from the world. And so she, in this book, talks much about the partnership, what she calls the private-public partnership, going on throughout through the United Nations programs, trying to hook up with and partner up with Christian and secular organizations, various environmental organizations, Sierra Club. See, Sierra Club and all these environmental groups are being funded now directly by the United Nations. And, you know, and they're inviting Christian organizations to come in and get their funding from the United Nations directly. Folks, we don't want to fall for that. You know, I think the Lord can provide our needs, don't you? You see, I feel like our founding fathers would just roll over in their graves if they saw the condition that this nation, this great nation, has come to. Our founding fathers gave us a constitutional republic. A lot of people think that America is a democracy. Not a democracy. Matter of fact, it's never been a democracy. In fact, our founding fathers said of a democracy that it was the devil's own form of government. Why is that? Because a democracy is mobocracy. And they didn't want mobocracy. So instead, they chose to give us a constitutional republic. What is a republic? A republic is government by elected officials, elected men. And our founding fathers told us, as soon as they gave us our republic, they said, we're giving you a republic if you can keep it. And the only way that you will be able to keep it, and they warned us, it says you need to elect from among your midst your best, your brightest, and your most moral, your most Christian, the men who stand up and lead your community in Christian values, is what they said. And why did they say that? Because they knew that mankind was a fallen being. Man is fallen. He needs checks and he needs balances on him. And in their desire to put these checks and balances, that's why they gave us a republic, because they knew that if we didn't get our most morally upstanding people to represent us, that we'd have problems because we were fallen people. They said, you have to have the best and most moral, because those people are even at times going to have to stand up to the very majority that elected them and put them in office. They're going to have to stand for right sometimes, even in the face of the people who elected them. Now, I don't hate to be the one to tell you this, and I'm sure that most of you already know this, but we are no longer a constitutional republic in America. Oh, sure, you can fly up to Washington, D.C., and you can go through and look at all the trappings of our republic. You can go see the Liberty Bell. You can go see the Constitution. But unfortunately, friends, I have to tell you the truth. We are not a constitutional republic anymore. We are a plutocracy. What is a plutocracy? A plutocracy is government by corporation, led by an elite. We are a government ruled and reigned by corporations, by special interest groups. You think you elect your officials. I'll tell you, the ones who finance these officials are corporations, special interest corporations. This is how it really works today, friends. Yes, they give us choices. Of course, our choices, their choices. You know, we get to choose from their choices. This is a plutocracy, and I don't know if you know this or not, but if you'll go look in your dictionary under fascism, you'll find that a plutocracy and fascism are identical. Fascism is a totalitarian form of government run and controlled by the corporate elite, by and for the corporate leaders, and held in power by a dictatorial military. Just study Mussolini. This is what fascism is. We today have a fascist form of government in running America today. As I continued to study along the lines of Plato, and getting into this polarization principle and studying Luciferianism and Satanism, which the Lord continued to lead me down that line. He said, I want you to study all facets of the occult. And so studying, when I did studies on Satanism and Luciferianism, I'd always run across something called the Kabbalah. The Kabbalah is the Hebrew book of black magic. And so every time I did a study into Luciferianism and Satanism, which, by the way, are different, and I go into that, the difference in my book somewhat, I would run across the Kabbalah. Let's go back to Atlantis here for a second. As I continued to study Atlantis, I found that these 10 kings, which I mentioned earlier, started off being very, very righteous, but they degenerated. In time, they degenerated, and they started off so supposedly using white magic for good, of course, you know. But in the end, the thing that brought the devastation, the flood, when Atlantis sank, the catastrophe that caused the sinking of Atlantis, it was brought on because these 10 kings had gone from using just white magic for good to using black magic for evil, and they were casting spells on each other and manipulating people. And so they had gotten to the place where they had degenerated, their whole society had degenerated. So as I began to study this whole concept and reading books like this one right here on Jewish mysticism, and I do recommend this one right here, I began to find out a whole lot about the Jewish mysticism, and that some Jewish people, not all certainly, a very small group of Jewish people were heavily involved in what we're talking about tonight, the New World Order. I began to study and found out that in the so-called continent of Atlantis, there was this power that these ten kings had tied into or tapped into to be able to function and to use this witchcraft on each other. And actually this force, if you want to use that term, permeated throughout Atlantis. And it was called Thule, T-H-U-L-E, Thule. And it was a little bit like the Star Wars movies. And probably everybody in here has seen Star Wars movies. You know, the Force. Luke Skywalker could come along and he could tap into this Force. Of course, he had to learn how to tap into it. Couldn't just do it. Had to learn how to access it. But if he could learn how to tap into this Force, then he could use it for good. But then, the dark side could come along. Darth Vader could come along, and he could tap into this same Force, and he could use it for evil. But it was one Force, a single Force. This is dualism. This is the stuff I was studying up until that time. Because all Satanists and Luciferians are Gnostic dualists. Now, what was the lie that Satan told Eve in the garden? Thou shalt be as God, knowing what? Good and evil. See, just think about it. You can become a God by knowing good and evil. Okay, we could just spend an hour right here on this, trying to understand dualism. But I found out that this dual force ran everything in continent Atlantis. They had flying machines that hovered around, that flew through the air, and it flew through by tapping into this power of Thule. They communicated with each other, supposedly, by tapping into the power of Thule. They had mental telepathy. And they could even use it for evil. Of course, you know, it wasn't recommended that you use black magic, just use white magic, you know. You know, you use white magic's fine, but if you use black magic, it messes up your whole karma, just ruins your whole karma. You know, you might have to come back as a bullfrog to get straightened out, you never know. So I began to study this Thule a little bit, and I began to find out quite a bit about it, and I began to find out that this was the basis of what many of these occult groups over in Europe had based much of their teachings on. And I began to study, and as I studied in Satanism and some of these groups, I ran across this guy right here, Sevi. And this guy was kind of a guru. This happened about 100 years before the French Revolution. And this guy was a known occultist of his day, kind of an Anton LaVey guru type combination thing. And I found out that the monarchs of England and all of Europe were sending ambassadors to this guy. And he supposedly was this great prophet. And he was a Jewish prophet. He was considered a Messiah figure among the Jews. But he was also had a tremendous influence on the monarchies and the elite of Europe. They actually sent, like I said, official emissaries to him. And he would levitate. One of the things he was most famous for, he would levitate about 2 or 3 foot off the ground, and then he'd just float around and give people prophecies. And apparently he did it, because you find any good Jewish dictionary that talks about messianic movements will mention this guy. This guy, I mean, he affected his day. He was a powerful, powerful occultist. And later he died, and when he died, a man by the name of Frank took over, another Jewish man, took over as another Messiah. He believed he was the reincarnation of Sevi. Thus, we refer to this whole cultic group as the Sabbatean Frankists. These were Jewish. A young man came along about the time, a little bit before the French Revolution, and Frank came on the scene about 50 years before the French Revolution. Well, not quite that much. His followers were very heavily involved with the French Revolution, supporting and financing the whole thing. But the Sabbatean Frankists were throughout Europe, and they were a banking cult, a Jewish banking cult that worked in and through and with the monarchs of Europe. And I document this whole thing, how this Thugenbund was the name of this particular one group that I document in this right in my book, the Thugenbund. A young man by the name of Bauer came along and joined, a young Jewish man by the name of Bauer came along and joined the Thugenbund, and eventually became very, very wealthy by working through this banking cult, and he later changed his name to Rothschild. Many people in here have heard that name, Rothschild, before. Well, the Thugenbund was a Thule group, or a Thugenbund, a Thule group, and they believed in all just what I just told you. They believed in this dualistic power that you could tap into, and that if you could tap into this power, you could have total supernatural power. You could even eventually become God, you see. One of the groups that the Thugenbund sponsored, one of many groups that the and men that these people financed, was this man right here by the name of Adam Weishaupt. This is the man that created the Bavarian Illuminati in 1776. And the thing he was most famous for was creating revolutions, and I guess probably the single thing he was most famous for. His disciples reached out throughout all of Europe and basically was able to take control of many of the Masonic lodges throughout all of Europe. And they basically just used the Masons as a tool, as a recruiting tool, and as a tool to be used as a front to recruit people to start and stop wars, to create revolutions. And he had no real love for the Freemasons, he just wanted to use them. And Adam Weishaupt told his disciples, he said, there's three types of people in the earth. He said, there's the type of people that make things happen, small minority of people, the kind of people that make things happen, the doers. He said, there's a much larger group of people in the earth, and he said, they're watchers. He said, they sit around and watch what the doers do, and criticize and complain. And he said, then there's another group that they don't do anything, you know. They don't know anything, and they don't do anything, and they don't care about anything. So we're going to be talking more about that as we go on. One of the things that I'd like to point out, and we're talking about Masons, and we'll be talking about Masons this evening, is really, we need to be real careful when we condemn Masons, because actually most Masons today are very touchy about the fact when you say something that the Masons could have been used as a tool by the Illuminati, or that they have been used as a tool by the Illuminati. I have a Uncle Elmo that's a Mason. You know, he rides these little motorcycles around, these little bicycles, and you know, honks horns and has himself a good time and gets about, you know, just three sheets in the wind and just has himself a ball. And Uncle Elmo has said, you know, I don't know anything about Lucifer. He says, I've been in the Masons for 30 years, and I never once heard the term Lucifer. And most of you all have an Uncle Elmo. We all know that if we, you know, Uncle Elmo saw Lucifer walking down the street, he wouldn't recognize him, you know. But yet, the truth is, and most Masons don't want to admit it, and they don't believe it, but it's true, that these Luciferian groups that I'll be talking about tonight actually reached in, took control of the very center of these organizations, and have used them ever since. Groups like the Illuminati under Weishaupt, but he's not the only one that did that. Now, let's go back for a minute to these concepts that Plato talked about in his dialogues. This man right here, John Ruskin, taught these Plato's concepts to the elite and the children of the monarchy in Oxford, England. And this was the center of an occult, these Luciferian centers are all over the world, actually, and they use certain educational establishments. In Oxford, this man right here, John Ruskin, was used to teach the children of the elite of Europe these concepts that we've just been talking about. He taught them that they were special, that they had something in their bloodstream that was special. You know, they call themselves blue bloods. They believe they have the right to rule because of what they call the divine right of kings. Now, what is the divine right of kings? What gives them, what makes them special? They're divine. Yes, they believe that the Bible gives them carte blanche to rule because God has set up this dynasty, these dynasties that these people are made up of. They marry, intermarry among each other, these monarchies, these dynasties, and they believe they're special. Well, one of the reasons they believe that they're special goes back to what we've been talking about, this Thule power. Now, there were, according to Plato, seven root races that were bred in this so-called lost continent of Atlantis. Seven root races, and only one of these root races escaped the flood. And supposedly they came down, they eventually settled over in Tibet, in that area over there, in the lost city of Shambhala. And the name of that root race was the Aryans. And so they believe, these occultists do, that the Aryans settled over there in the Tibetan mountains, eventually migrated down into England and over into the Scandinavian areas and became the blue-eyed, the offshoots of this became the blue-eyed Scandinavians, blonde-headed Scandinavians. But many of them settled over in England too, and various other places. Well, you see, they believed that they were special. They were blue bloods. They were special because there was something latent in their bloodstream that was not latent in any other group. They believed they were descended from these Aryans that had come down and escaped out of the lost continent Atlantis. Now, I know that sounds stupid, but these people actually believe this stuff. They believe that there's something latent inside the bloodstream of all those who are descended from this so-called Aryan race that was bred in Atlantis. And so the thing that makes them special and the reason why they interbreed only among themselves is because they have something called vril, V-R-I-L, latent in their bloodstream. It's kind of a... Well, it's only the people that were descended from this Aryan race has this trace element, you might say, of vril in their bloodstream. So they believe that they're special. They believe that they should marry only each other. And this man right here taught such concepts to the monarchy's children over in Oxford, England. So one of the young men that sat under him, one of his students, was a young man by the name of Cecil Rhodes. Cecil Rhodes set up a secret society financed by the Cecils. Now, if you'll notice his name is spelled C-E-C-I-L. Most people pronounce it Cecil Rhodes, but it's not. It's Cecil Rhodes. And I won't go into the whole reason why he's named that, but let me just say that the group that put, that controlled Oxford, they used this as a center to train their people, as an indoctrination area, to train their children and the other people that they brought in. How many of you ever heard of the Rhodes Secret Society or the Rhodes Trust. Our buddy Bill Clinton came from there, right? Well, it was a training area. And the people that actually ran Oxford, England, were the Cecil family. Not Cecil, but Cecil. How many in here saw last month's documentary on the History Channel about Queen Elizabeth the First? Anybody? Just one? Maybe a couple. Okay, there's two or three. Hopefully you'll remember in there that she had a dynastic family that ruled behind her throne. It was the Cecils. And if you remember the documentary, his son took over after the senior Cecil died, and then his son, and the Cecils actually have been behind the power behind the throne of England since the late 1500s. And in that documentary, he talked about how that Queen Elizabeth I gave out these charters, or monopolies, as they were also called, over certain aspects of natural resources or grain or whiskey or, you know, all of her favorite people, the people that ran her kingdom, her administrators, all had these monopolies given to her. Well, the Cecils were the highest ranking group, and they had the opium monopoly. The Cecil family has had the opium monopoly since 1600s, since actually December of 1600 is when they actually got that monopoly given to them. This is the wealthiest family in the whole world. The Cecils makes the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers look like paupers. Yet you'll never find their name on any Fortune 500 list of the world's wealthiest people. Actually, the Rothschilds, after they made all their money, they were allowed to begin to marry into the Cecils. And the Cecils and the Rothschilds have intermarried since the Rothschilds came on the scene and since they made all their money, starting in the early 1800s. So you can understand kind of what I'm getting ready to say here next. The Cecils financed Cecil Rhodes Cecils and the Rothschilds. They set up actually a series of seven wills, Cecil Rhodes did. And these wills were put in place to finance this Rhodes secret society to take over and create a new world order and to break America into it. And what is Cecil Rhodes most famous for? Probably he was the one that went over, you'll say, that he went over and was the guy that took over the diamonds and the gold in South Africa. Actually, to do that, he was the first one to implement the prison camp. And he created a war called the Boer War. And he fought the Dutch Boers, and he took their women and children and captured them, put it in concentration camps, and literally starved them to death by the thousands, much like Hitler did later in his death camps. They died of typhoid. They died of all kinds of diseases. It's terrible what they did. Why did Cecil Rhodes, or why was he financed by the Rockefellers, or rather by the Rothschilds and by the Cecils, to go out and to do what he did? Really, what they wanted was people like Cecil Rhodes. They sent them out as kind of like missionaries. And their goal, and Cecil Rhodes by far was not the only one. They also financed other men to gain the control of the natural resources of the earth. Why did they want to do that? You see, they believe in something a little bit like this Gaia religion, this Mother Earth religion that many of you in here probably have heard of. And they believed that mankind was evolving. And for mankind to evolve, he has to have all his internal organs. He has to have his heart, his kidneys, his liver. He has to have all of his internal organs for him to continue to live and to evolve. But these people also have this pantheistic belief that man and the earth are one. And they had this symbiotic belief that man needs the earth and earth needs the man. Now, what do I am talking about here? They also believe that the earth is evolving. This is the same thing that this John Ruskin taught Rhodes and taught these children of the monarchy. He said, the earth is evolving, man is evolving, the earth needs man needs the earth. And they believe that the earth is evolving and man together is going to evolve till they come out here, somewhere out here in the future, called the Omega Point, where earth and man are going to come together, evolve to a certain place, and then there's going to be this quantum leap into a new age, and man has to evolve, and earth has to evolve in a process that is symbiotic, because for earth to evolve, guess what? It needs all of its internal organs, or it needs all of its internal natural resources. Now you're beginning, I see the light coming on, people. These people believed that if man could evolve, he needed the chemicals of the earth, because see, they promote chemical use of drugs because it expands your mind, you understand? You see. And if you get your mind expanded, then you can come up with all these wonderful technologies and inventions and chemical compounds, and through using these chemical compounds, and you're learning how the earth is magnetic waves, and how to learn how to develop all these new technologies. If man will do that, then they can go over here and use all these technologies to help earth evolve. So this is symbiotic. It's dependent on each other. I know it sounds crazy, but it doesn't matter. These people believe this stuff. So earth, they want to control all the natural resources in the earth because they believe it's part and parcel of this evolutionary concept of coming into this omega point. They believe the earth is evolving. They want to control the whole earth. Now, if you'll listen to them, they'll tell you that man is the problem here. See, man is the problem. They have got to control all the natural resources of the earth, and they also have to control all the men of the earth because they have to control the breeding practices of men. So maybe you'll kind of get an understanding of where they're going with this thing. These two men right here are referred to in my book as social Darwinists. And what's a social Darwinist, Bill? These men, these two men right here, J.P. Morgan and Rockefeller, are referred to by most historians as two of America's greatest capitalists. But they are not capitalists. They are monopolists. Matter of fact, Rockefeller said that he hated capitalism, that he hated competition. He called competition a sin. He destroyed all of his competitors, literally destroyed them. And then this other man here, J.P. Morgan, him and Rockefeller absolutely hated each other. Now, Morgan didn't have very many oil wells, and he didn't get into oil much, but he owned the railroads. And Rockefeller had to depend on him early on before he built his pipelines. He had to depend on Morgan to get his oil transported. And so these men dealt with each other, but they hated each other. Actually, I show in my book how that Morgan was a complete creation of the Rothschilds, but that Rockefeller actually was forced into this New World Order. Of course, that once they came in, they've been a willing accomplice ever since. But they was actually forced into this thing. You see, Adam Weishaupt sent his disciples out and said, you go out there and bring the movers and the shakers, the doers, and you bring them in and you force them in any way you can. If you can recruit them through the Masons, well and good. If you can't recruit them in through the Masons, then you go out and provide them with women. You set them up. You get blackmail them. Whatever you have to do, you put them in a position where you can control them and you bring them into this thing. Actually, Rockefeller was forced into into this new world order by what I call in my book the Great Oil War. He was in a life and death struggle with his oil monopoly, Standard Oil, with the Rothschilds, and had to deal with men like J.P. Morgan and other Rothschild agents. So he was actually forced into this thing. See, this is what the Illuminati does. It goes out and finds the movers and the shakers in society. If you reach a particular level of wealth and influence and influence and control over technology, you will be tapped and approached by these people. How many know Ted Turner learned that lesson real well, real fast? Bill Gates, however, has been real slow to learn that lesson. And if he doesn't learn, if he doesn't learn kind of how the game is being played and who's running things, these people will eventually destroy him. If they can't get some kind of control on him, they will eventually destroy him. You see, that's how they took over Rockefeller. And they will take over anybody that reaches a high level of control over technology or just has a lot of money. See, they'll use you, you're just a tool in their hands. And they'll bring you into this thing any way they can get you in. Social Darwinism. Most people don't really know much about Darwin. And one of the things that these people promoted was tooth and claw capitalism. They believed in the survival of the fittest and the removal of the weak. See, Darwin had two relatives that started what we today call the population control movement. Everybody in here heard of the Club of Rome? Most people, okay. Well, this is the modern day version, and one of the tools to promote this population control movement in our day. But, you know, in Darwin's day, he had two relatives that promoted this, one being a minister by the name of Robert Malthus. I think he was his first or second cousin. And Malthus promoted the elimination of children, the elimination of people that were just useless. And see, this is all part and parcel of what these social Darwinists believe. They believe in tooth and claw capitalism, if you want to call it capitalism, it's really monopolism. And they believe in tooth and claw social engineering, or the breeding of the races, who can live and who can die. These two foundations that I'm going to talk about here in a second, actually, Andrew Carnegie, a while ago I showed you a picture of Rhodes. Rhodes is part of this secret society that I talked about just a minute ago, created foundations to promote this New World Order that he was involved with. Well, a man by the name of Andrew Carnegie was connected with this whole thing. Actually, he made most of his money doing steel bridges, a lot of it, but it was all financed by Rothschild money. He built bridges across most of our major rivers here in America. His steel mills built the steel, and then he contracted to have the bridges built, and the financing came from the Rothschilds over in Europe. Well, he set up a foundation to extend to be an American extension of the Rhodes Foundation, and he called it the Carnegie Foundation. This is the same foundation that gives you Sesame Street. And so when Carnegie eventually decided to sell his steel mills, he sold his steel mills to J.P. Morgan and handed over this Carnegie Foundation to J.P. Morgan. So from that time on, J.P. Morgan controlled the Carnegie Foundation. Along the same time, after Rockefeller was brought into this thing, forced into it, he created the Rockefeller Foundations, more than one, several. These two foundations, the Andrew Carnegie Foundations and the Rockefeller Brothers Foundations, the various ones, there's many that they created, have since that time worked together as literally one group. And they have they've reached out, they took over the American Medical Association. They reached out, they were able to use those finances to take over the American public education establishment. And one of the things they used their money and influence for was to create a pseudoscience called eugenics. Everybody here, anybody in here heard of the eugenics movement? Recently, there's been a few good books written on it. It's actually a travesty in our history. Around the turn of the century, these foundations hired pseudoscientists, set up these organizations, these so-called scientific organizations. They put money behind the election of politicians who they could control to pass laws called eugenics laws. And they would go out and they would round up all the people that they did not feel was fit to reproduce and to breed. They would go into orphanages and literally sterilize hundreds and thousands of young men. Most of these young men never realized why they were sterile until they begin to look back and they begin to trace back. And some of these books can give you some of these horror stories. They literally sterilized hundreds of thousands of young men right here in America. And then their so-called scientists would come up with these scientific experiments to tell whether you was smart enough to breed or not. And they'd feel your head, see you had so many bumps back here, or they'd check the size of your skull or the shape of your skull, and if they didn't like what they see, they'd sterilize you. They did this to young men primarily, and some young girls, but mostly men, and the young men were usually so young that they didn't even know what was going on. See? And they took this same philosophy, these same foundations, these pseudoscientific organizations, they took the pattern that they had created right here in America, and they took that pattern, they took it over into Germany, and they reproduced it. And they created foundations over there to support these so-called pseudoscientific organizations, these scientific organizations. They hired scientists, and probably over in Germany, the best known of these organizations was the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute of eugenics. Anybody ever heard of the doctor of death, Joseph Mengele, the guy that did all the experiments on the twins in the camps? He worked for the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute of Eugenics before he went to work for Hitler. So you can kind of understand where we're going with this thing. These people went over into Germany and set up these organizations, and this became, and using the Andrew Carnegie Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundations, they put up a lot of the early money for what eventually became known as the Nazi movement. Now, very quickly, this is Madame Blavatsky. Isn't she a pleasant-looking soul? Doesn't she just look like she exudes the love of Jesus? She was the founder of the Theosophical Society. This woman worships Lucifer. She believes Lucifer is God. She created the Theosophical Society. Adolf Hitler came along, and he was raised up by these people, financed by these people. He was a theosophist. He read, now Madame Blavatsky wrote a number of books, the best known being The Secret Doctrine. And Hitler is reported to have read The Secret Doctrine on a daily basis, nearly every day. He read it just like you and I would read our Bibles. So every day he sat there and read about this lost continent Atlantis that Blavatsky talked about. He read about the Thule society, the Thule power that emanated throughout this so-called lost continent of Atlantis. And all, she called it by Thule, she called it by other names also. But Hitler read her writings every single day. So you may get an idea here. And you can get her books too. In any occult bookstore, I recommend, though, that you just stick with the Bible. You can get them, though, at any occult bookstore. Then, the other thing that you need to know about these theosophists is they are basically ran out of and financed out of a 1 square mile in the heart of London, England, called the City. It's ground zero for the Masonic international banking set. It's a square mile inside London, England, and it's its own little enclave. It's kind of like the Vatican is in Rome. Well, you have to ask permission to come in. Matter of fact, when the Queen of England comes in, she has to ask permission to enter, and when she does, she has to walk 10 paces behind the Lord Governor. So we get straight on who's running things, okay, around there. Inside there, there's 2,000 police officers that work for the City of London. Why 2,000 officers for a 1 square mile area? Why would you need 2,000 police officers working in 1 square mile? Because there's 560 some banks in that 1 square mile of London called the City. One being the Bank of England, which the Rothschilds took over. It's all in my book here. One being the Rothschilds Bank, and actually all the great international banking syndicates throughout the world have at least an office branch there. So you have 560 banks within 1 square mile area of London, and you cannot come in this place. Well, you can come in, but you have to be invited in, because this is ground zero for the Masonic movement, or what I call in here in my book, the Masonic International Central Banking Conspiracy. In my book, I have a chapter on the Federal Reserve, and then another one on the central banks of the world, of which our Federal Reserve is just one part. If you want to know where it's run from, it's run from a 1 square mile area in London, and then our stock market, our stock exchange, our Wall Street in New York City is just really a branch of this right here. So you kind of get an understanding of who runs things and how things run. They run by the power of money. Hitler was raised up to create a war. You see, these people create wars. They make a lot of money out of wars. But not only do they make a lot of money out of wars, they also use wars to control population. You see, they have a population agenda, and they also are into making money. But this is part and parcel of what these people do. This is a good book by the Pools. I would recommend you get this book. This book has a lot to say about the corporations that run and control, who were used to create the Nazi military-industrial complex. And although this doesn't get into the groups that actually, the occult groups that raised Hitler to power, we will be touching on that. This is a very good book. I do recommend it. In Susan and James Poole's book, Who Financed Hitler, you will learn about I.G. Farben. I.G. Farben was at that time the world's largest chemical company. It was actually started as a dye company by the Frankists, and eventually grew again, like I said, into the world's largest chemical company. It became Hitler's military-industrial complex major corporation. Its scientists were used, its engineers were used to basically design much, if not most, of Hitler's war implements. And what few people understand about I.G. Farben is that it was the basic corporation that built Hitler's death camps. They would take and lease the prisoners in Hitler's death camps to build and to fulfill various contracts for I.G. Farben. Who owned I.G. Farben? You'd be totally shocked. In this book, you'll find that many large American corporations, many well-known American capitalists, such as Rockefeller, was probably one of the major stockholders in I.G. Farben. And so you begin to get an idea of how these major American financiers operate on both sides. Ford was building trucks here in America for the Allies, and yet at the same time he had factories going on night and day over in Germany building German trucks for Hitler's war machine. So you got to understand what goes on behind the scenes in these powerful dynastic families. The amount of spilt blood is irrelevant to these people. The bottom line is what they consider to be important, the almighty dollar. The Children of the Sun was an organization that tied in directly with another organization I'm going to be talking about here in a minute, the Black Sun Society. The Children of the Sun was an English counterpart to the German Black Sun Society. We'll get into that here in just a minute. You know, every once in a while, if you know who these dynastic families are and you know a little bit of something about them, sometimes the veil is rent and you can kind of get a little bit of a glimpse behind the scenes to understand. You know, God created the family. It was God's idea of the family. Western civilization depends on it. The Grecian and Roman empires collapsed from within because of homosexuality and the demise of the family. So God anoints families. How many of you know God's anoints families? Well, you know, Satan comes along and he imitates God. Satan came to Jesus once and said, if you'll just fall down and worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world and the power and the glory thereof. Of course, we know Jesus turned him down. But in my book, I document the families that did not turn down this offer. And since those times, since that time when they came into this thing, they have received an anointing and power and authority and provision from Lucifer to help him build his kingdom. These people are the wealthiest people in the world. They are the power behind kings. They have the influence, and actually, if you get to studying and looking what they do, they have an anointing, a satanic anointing to do what they do. They are diabolically clever. Okay, this is Prince Edward, Prince of Duke of Windsor. He married an American by the name of Wallace Simpson. And how many of you know that he had to abdicate the throne because he chose to marry her? And of course, most people believe the reason why he had to abdicate the throne is if you are the King of England, you automatically become head of the Church of England. And so as the story goes, the cover story goes, well, he had to abdicate the throne because as the head of the Church of England, he could not be married to a divorcee. But that is not the real story. If you study behind the scenes what really went on during this wedding and what went on around it following it, you get some interesting insight. Actually, Edward was a member of this dualistic group called the Children of the Sun. The reason him and Wallace Simpson got together, he sponsored a man, a military man, to come in to join in and become part of this Children of the Sun Society. This man was Wallace Simpson's husband. Now, actually, Wallace Simpson and the Duke of Windsor actually met here in America for the first time in San Diego at the Coronado Hotel. And they were having one of their little enclaves, and of course, I don't want to go into it, but if you understand the morals of these people, they were basically having a little orgy there, one of those little enclaves they get together, and her husband just passed him, Wallace, off to the prince. Of course, that was okay, because he had so many girlfriends, he really didn't have time for Wallace anyway. And so that's how Wallace and the prince actually got together right here in America to begin with. And of course, they went back over there. Now, I said a while ago, if you know a little bit about these families, these powerful dynasties that I mentioned throughout my book, then you can understand a little bit about who's running things. The reason why that Edward had to abdicate the throne was because of a little quarrel that took place between the Cecils and the Rothschilds. You got to remember now what I said earlier. These people believe that this real substance, trace element, is in the bloodline of the monarchy of Europe. And so the powers that be, the Cecil, said there's no way he's going, a Merovingian is one of the other names that they call themselves, the Merovingian dynasty. Don't have time to get into all that. But they said a Merovingian is no way we're going to let a Merovingian dynasty marry into an a Kerr American. There's no Vril in the blood. She's not from an Aryan background. Now you see, Diana could marry into royalty because she was a Spencer, and a Spencer is one of about 3 to 4 dozen of these families over there that supposedly has the Vril, the trace of Vril, in their bloodline. And of course, it wouldn't also not do for a Merovingian like Diana to marry an Arab either, see? So you might get a little clue there of what's going on behind the background too. So here we go. The Rothschild said, hey, it's just fine, let him go ahead and marry her because the Vril spark is passed on by the male anyway. So it's not really a big deal. So the Rothschilds argued, you know, let him stay. Let him marry her, big deal. What's the deal? But the Cecils, on the other hand, said, no way, Jose. We're not going to tolerate this. A Merovingian will not marry a Kerr American. There is no Vril there. We will not tolerate it. So there was an argument went on for about a period of about 3 or 4 months there, whether he was going to be allowed to marry her or not. Finally, one day, the Cecils called in Winston Churchill and said, you go pack the king's bags and you send him packing. He's out of here. So who runs things? Does that give you any clue who runs things? Who's the most powerful, the Cecils or the Rothschilds? So in retaliation, the Rothschilds say, okay, fine. So where do you think Wallace and Edward honeymoon at? At one of the Rothschilds' mansions. And who do you think pays for to send these two around the world on this whirlwind honeymoon that they had? The Rothschilds. See, you got to learn who these people are, and I mention these people throughout my book. Learn these families. And you'll learn to look behind the scenes, you'll learn who's pulling the strings, what's really going on, see? That's just one little example that you can see who really is the most powerful of these dynasties. So that's, you know, and this whole Thule, Vril concept runs these monarchies. It determines who they can marry and who they can't marry. Here, anybody know who that is? Everybody recognize who that is? It's Henry Ford. He is receiving an accommodation. He received many awards and accommodations from Hitler. This man here who is placing this accommodation on him, which I believe in this particular instance is the German cross, is a representative of Hitler. Hitler loved Henry Ford. Hitler had a picture of Henry Ford in his office. He loved Henry Ford. You've got to understand what goes on behind the scenes in these powerful occultic groups, because you'll never really understand Hitler without understanding the power of Thule and the power of Vril. Hundreds of historians have written books about what Hitler did. But there isn't a handful of books out there written on why Hitler did what he did. Folks, you're going to soon understand here in just a minute why he did what he did. See, as a theologian is studying, you know, coming from a theological background, I want to know why people do what they do. Because I know people are motivated by their belief system. Hitler had a belief system. Remember I said a while ago he studied Madame Blavatsky's books, he studied her on a daily basis. He was trying to accomplish something. He had a plan to his motives. He had a game plan. This book by Peter Moon documents to some degree a little of what was going through the mind of Hitler. A while ago I mentioned the Black Sun Society and said that it was a German counterpart to the English Children of the Sun. This was a Thulistic group. It was the group that coordinated two other groups that was not so secretive. And those two groups was the Thule Society and the Vril Society. And now you understand, of course, the concept behind those names. The Thule Society and the Vril Society were the outward organizations that really raised Hitler up from day one and turned a paper hanger into a dictator and financed him every step of the way. IG Farben was just one of the corporations that these secret societies owned and controlled. George Bush Sr.'s grandfather worked for Brown Brothers Harriman. Brown Brothers Harriman was one of the major contributors. It was a coordinating organization that coordinated between the American capitalists and the German capitalists, and basically was the American Foreign Office for IG Farben. And that was George Bush's grandfather who was the main go-between under Hitler, IG Farben, and Brown Brothers Harriman. So you begin to look behind the scenes and see some of these families and some of the roots and some of these people were involved and how they came up to power. In Peter Moon's book, he documents much about the Thule Society, the Vril Society. And then if you look at the bottom of the cover, you'll see that this is a Tibetan priest depicted here at the bottom. Hitler created this little enclave inside Berlin and brought to Berlin over 300 Tibetan priests. And when the Russians invaded ahead of the Allied forces, when they came in before the Americans came into Berlin, they found 300 dead Tibetan priests in this compound. Why were they there? Why did Hitler bring them to Germany? Well, this book will document to a degree, and I've been doing a lot of study along this line, how that these Tibetan priests were the channelers between Hitler and the lost mystical city of Shambhala, where supposedly the ascended masters, are those demigods, those people who have evolved past humanity. And they've evolved so far out there that they're no longer operating in this plane. They're just out there. They operate on a whole new level, a whole plane of existence that we haven't evolved to yet, okay? And so Hitler believed he was receiving instructions from these ascended masters. And these 300 Tibetan priests were doing channeling between Hitler and Tibet using Tibetan tarot cards. And they were leaving their bodies. They were doing astral projection. They were just doing all kinds of different things to provide Hitler with all the information that he was getting, supposedly, directly from these ascended masters from Shambhala. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? This man was a madman. This is the kind of stuff that starts and stops wars. This is the kind of stuff that kills millions and millions of people. These crazy ideas. Yet to these people, they believe this stuff. Doesn't matter if you and I believe it. Doesn't matter how crazy you and I think this whole thing is. This has been the source of the death of millions of people. These Tibetan priests were found. So it's documented. The Russians documented it. We documented it. They were there. Hitler used them. He would at times go into trances with these guys. And he was called the carpet biter. When he would go into a trance with these people or go into these little seances they had, he had many times would fall on the ground and scratch and bite the carpet, just act like a madman. I give two or three instances in here, document these various manifestations of things he would go into. He just turned into a crazy man. He's a madman anyway, but I mean, you have to understand what was going through the mind of Hitler. Now, I put this this screen up the other day and ended up breaking when I was doing a teaching and didn't get a chance to get into it a little bit. And so I just left it up during the break, and one lady come to me and she said, you know, but when you put something like this up on the screen, you know, all of a sudden people look at you, start kind of funny and say, okay. And she came up and said, do you believe that there's little green men on Mars? And I said, I don't know. I've never been there. I don't know if there's little green men on Mars. What you're seeing here has nothing to do with little green men from Mars, I assure you. Nothing to do with aliens. What you're looking at is the Vril 7. How many of you know that Hitler had tremendous technological advances over and above the Allies? Actually, if it hadn't been the fact that Mussolini had messed his whole game plan up and he had to send his troops over into Russia late, and they end up being starved to death over there and froze to death, if it hadn't been for that, he might have won that war. And he certainly would have won it on technological grounds, because he had things in the works that our people was absolutely astonished to find when we went over there and looked around. And our people discovered much of these technological advances when we went in under Operation Paperclip. We went in and began to bring their scientists out. Even before the end of the war, we sent in people and began to make arrangements to recruit their scientists and their intelligence establishments. I don't know if any of y'all in here have ever heard of the Gehling Org. Hitler's intelligence establishment, almost intact, was brought out of Germany by the Dulles brothers, Henry Kissinger, and other men who worked on that project to get those people out of there. And those people, the Gehling Org, was eventually turned into your CIA. The OSS was reorganized and the Gehling Org was brought in. You people have no concept that half of the CIA was Nazis and the other half was these Thule groups, like the Skull and Bone groups that Bush came out of. You see, we need to know these things, friends. Can you trust your CIA? Not any more than you can trust the Nazis. That's how the CIA was created and the people used to create it. Now let's talk about the scientists for a minute under Operation Paperclip. And this picture is part of the documentation that Operation Paperclip went back and got all this information and brought it back to America when they brought back the scientists. Hitler, up until what I said, until the catastrophe happened to him in Russia, where his men froze to death, he was going along pretty good. At that point in time, he was pretty convinced that they probably might lose the war because of that. Up until that time, he was putting his investment dollars, his military-industrial complex, as far as his rocketry programs was concerned, he was investing it in two different directions, the implosive and the explosive. Let me say that again, the implosive and the explosive. The explosive is normal rocketry that you know about from watching your History Channel. You saw the documentations probably of what was done down in Putumayo under von Braun. And you probably all know that under Operation Paperclip, von Braun and his associates were brought to America, and that NASA was built around those scientists. Probably everybody understands that. But what you probably don't know is that the other half of that equation, the implosive technology, that was the experiments and the rocketry the side of the equation, they were trying to tap into this Thule force and they call this whole technology Vril technology, because they were trying to tap the power of Thule. Remember I said a while ago, Sevi was levitated. They were trying to tap the understanding of tapping into Thule to be able to levitate, and this was the whole basis, and this is why they call this whole branch of technology the Thule branch of technology, the implosive. They created, we know they created it. We have all the documentation under Operation Paperclip was brought out. Matter of fact, we went over and got not only the V2 the rockets, you know about all that, but we also got this technology right here, and we brought it back. Hitler had a whole series of these real saucers made. Now, this thing couldn't even leave Earth's atmosphere. It was not a flying saucer like you're thinking about. No little green men involved. We're talking about pure German science here, okay? The real three actually took part in the Battle of Britain, and they said it was so unstable, they was lucky to get it back to Germany. This picture right here is of the Vril 7. This is particular craft right here operated off 12 BMW engines, and it really was just a different form of a helicopter. It still operated off aerodynamic lift, off blades that were run by 12 motors. I won't say standard motors, but 12 motors. And so they were trying to slowly evolve this technology. And the thing that made this technology right here in the Vril 7 so different and advanced is their guidance system operated off electromagnetic technology that they eventually transformed over and began to use on the later Vrils. By the time they got to the Vril 9, 10, 11, and 12, the whole propulsion system was run by electromagnetic waves. And at that point in time, I'm told that they had, by the time they got to the Vril 12, 11 and 12, they were actually able, by using electromagnetic power, they were actually able to leave the Earth's atmosphere. Well, you know, I have no documentation on that. I have no proof on that. This is the rumor. As a matter of fact, I haven't come across anybody yet that has come up with any real solid documentation about the Vril 11 and 12. So what I'm telling you is just pure rumor. But I suspect, and I have no proof of this, but I suspect that they did with this technology just exactly what they did with the Punamunde technology. They went over there and got these scientists under Operation Paperclip, and they brought all the Punamunde scientists to America and cleaned up the records, took away all their Nazi records, put them to work for the American military industrial complex or related corporations. They gave them sometimes even new names and created jobs for them. And of course, that was our space industry. But the exact same thing was true for the implosive technology. They went over and got this same technology, and they brought it back to America, and they went over and got the same scientists that was working on this branch of the technology, and they brought them to America. Of course, you won't see that on the History Channel. And I assume, I don't know this to be true, but I kind of suspect that most of this old German technology was stored in what we call Area 51. Now, there have been a whole lot of crazy things said about Area 51. I don't know what's true and what's not true. Could it be that, because these people are Luciferians, Satanists, could it be that they joined in, brought these scientists to America and just continued the same study and research that they were doing in Germany, right over here in America with CIA financing? And could they have actually, since they are Satanists, you got to understand what runs the SS. These people are pure Satanists. I document the whole thing in my book. I go into the rituals, Himmler's rituals. You can't believe all the stuff that's going on. Could it be that these scientists teamed up with demons for extra knowledge? I don't know. You know, you hear so many crazy stories about what went on at Area 51. I don't pretend to even understand what all went on, what's true or what's not true. But the truth is, you're seeing an actual picture of German technology. Again, we're not talking about aliens here, friends. We're talking about German technology that is far superior to ours. Friends, I assure you, the New World Order has technology that's so far superior. They're not showing us even a little bit of it, but they have technology that's so far superior to us, and they're not telling us anything about it. Here you have chakras, the major seven chakras. And if you learn how to like the force. You know, you had to learn how to tap into that force to, for either good or bad. Well, if you learn how to develop your chakras, you can access the power of Thule. Shirley MacLaine would be absolutely proud of me. Talking about her chakras. She can't talk without talking about her chakras, chakra power. You see, she says it's the evolutionary path, your evolutionary path to Godhood. If you can only tap into this Thule force, then you can tap into the force that will actually make a God out of you. And you don't need the Holy Spirit to do this. You can do this on your own terms. You see, you can tap into that force and you can use it for good, or you could use it for bad, but Shirley doesn't really recommend that you use it for bad, because again, it just messes up your whole karmic, you know, calendar, and you just, you know, you have to come back, and it's just, it takes a long time, and you know, you might have to be a, you know, a June bug, or who knows what you had to become, you know, to get all straightened out karmically, you know, you don't want to do that. It's bad, bad business. So just use it for good witchcraft, okay? Just good white magic. Yeah. So you can have the, ability to become God yourself if you just would develop your chakras and develop your ability to tap into this force that's out there and available to all of us. The threefold flame of life. And down at the bottom, you'll see it says the alchemy, power of wisdom, love. What is alchemy? Alchemy is the science, the so-called science of being able to take a metal or an element and change it, its basic structure, to another element. You see, the whole the alchemists of old were always trying to change lead into gold. Okay? But you see, the type of alchemy that Shirley MacLaine talks about and these New Agers talk about is how that you can become God. You can become God if you, and this flame here, this three-period flame here, is the force of Thule. You can tap into this thing, the threefold flame of God. Masons here who know a little bit of something about Mason will know this represents the lost secret. The lost words, don't have time to go into all that. But it's the old concept, again, Thule, power, even though the eight New Ages will call it by other names besides Thule, it's still basically the same thing. Becoming the Christ, the New Age movement. The New Age movement believes that you can get in your evolutionary path towards God. And, of course, this is this threefold flame here again. If you look behind Christ here in this flame, the threefold flame of life, your opportunity to become the Christ. See, this is it. If you don't develop your chakras, friends, if you don't get with the program, friends, you're going to be left behind. If you don't learn how to develop into Godhood, when these people come on the scene and they bring their New Age and their new world order to the forefront, you're going to be left behind. There will not be room in their millennium for you. You'll be a useless eater. You'll be useless to them. And they've already said they're going to have to dispose of you. Oh, I wish we had another hour. I could give you quote after quote by these nuts. And they come right out and say, we're going to get rid of you if you don't evolve and come into our millennium. They're going to, and these people are serious. They're just as serious as Hitler was serious. What was Hitler trying to do? What was he trying to do? He was trying to recreate, to rebreed the Aryan race by tapping into and using the power through Thule, by using Vril. He was going to tap into the force of Thule, and he was going to rebreed, bring back into existence the Aryan race. He had this religious concept that he could do it. And so what did he do? He approached this problem that he had from two different angles. First of all, he went over and created this breeding colony, went out and got all the blue-eyed, blonde-headed young ladies, you know, the finest stock throughout Germany, and he put them in these camps as breeding stock. And then he went over and got all the big, strong, good-looking young males and brought them in, and they were just breeding stock. They had this breeding program going on. They gave, through these camps, they bred thousands of young German boys and girls. This is a fact, friends. But they also did the other part of the equation, the negative part, because he said, I have to do the positive and the negative. The negative part of this thing, he said, we not only have to breed and bring about this Aryan race by breeding it back, but there's a problem. It's this mongrel races out here, and he had a laundry list of about 14 to 16 races, the Jews, the Poles, the Gypsies, all these races he called mongrel races that he said were keeping this Aryan race from coming back into being bred back into existence. So the negative part of this, he said, we're going to have to eliminate these bloodlines from Germany. We're going to have to kill them all. So you can see now what was the concept was going on in the mind of Hitler. He was breeding the Aryans, but at the same time he was killing the non-Aryans, those which he called curl bloodlines. And you don't know this, friends, because nobody has told you until today, but I'll let you in on a little secret that not any of you, the Christian historians or pastors, are telling you, but 3 to 4 million Christians, and I document the whole thing right here in my book, 3 to 4 million Christians died in those concentration camps right alongside the Jews and the Poles and the Gypsies because he called us Jewish dumb. 3 to 4 million Christians died in those camps, my friends. Could something like that happen in America today? Could we be in America where these Jewish races and these other races were in starting about 39? Well, something to think about. Something to think about. All right, let's shift gears just a little bit. Remember I said earlier that back in the early days, I was doing a Bible study in the book of Daniel, and I discovered that there's a lot said in the book of Daniel about world government. If you got your Bibles tonight, let's just kind of shift gears and get a little bit over into Bible prophecy, and we'll take 30 years of study and cram it into about 15 minutes here, okay? I think we can do it. We'll give it a shot. If you remember your Sunday school lessons, you'll remember a little bit about Daniel. Daniel was taken over into Babylon, and the Jews were taken over into Babylon. And over in Babylon, Daniel was able to interpret a dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had, and the figure you see before him represents what he saw in that dream. He couldn't remember the dream, so Daniel came in and interpreted the dream for him, and what he said and what he interpreted was this. He said, O King Nebuchadnezzar, thou art this head of gold. Thou art the Babylonian kingdom. The head of gold represents Babylon. And you remember the many, many Tekel Upharsin? He said, you're going to be overthrown. And they were overthrown by the arms here, the silver arms of, and two shoulders of silver, which represented the Medo-Persian Empire. And then you have the belly of brass, which represented the Grecian empires, which overthrew the Medo-Persians. And then you have the two legs. These represent the eastern and western divisions. They were legs of iron. They represented the Roman Empire, which overthrew the Grecian Empire. And down at the bottom there, you will see the feet. Now, everybody in here, I'm sure, is probably pretty much grounded in much of what I'm talking about, or the majority of you are. You know a little bit about Bible prophecy, probably far more than the average person does out on the street out here, and far more than the average person sitting in the pew in our churches. These 10 toes in the 2 feet of this statue here, this representation here, represent what Bible scholars and prophecy scholars call the revised Roman Empire. The theory being that these 2 feet and the 10 toes represent the last day manifestation, the extension of the Roman Empire. So it's often called the revised Roman Empire. Now, those of you who will still remember your Bible school lessons, your Sunday school lessons. You will maybe remember what happens to these 10 feet. What happens to the 10 feet? A stone cut without hands comes down and smashes into the 10 toes, and then the rest of the whole thing comes crashing down upon the stone. It's turned into dust and it's blown away like chaff. So, what does that stone represent? That stone is Christ. That stone, when it hits these 10 toes, this whole thing crumbles, turns to dust, blown away. That stone turns into a mountain. It represents the millennial reign of our Lord Jesus Christ. So the stone destroys, the coming of Lord Jesus Christ destroys the 10 toes, the last day manifestation of this revived Roman Empire. What does the 10 toes represent? Well, this is a matter of debate. Daniel wanted to know what these 10 toes, he wanted to understand more of what he had seen. So he prayed, he received a vision of 4 beasts. This beast is the 4th beast. And if you want to read this, I suggest that you look on Daniel. You can look up later, may take notes. Daniel 7, 7 to 8, Daniel 7, 19, 26, talking about this 10-horned beast. This 4th beast was diverse from the other beasts. It had 10 horns, if you'll notice, upon its head. And in the middle of these 10 horns is what we call the little horn. We call him the beast. How many of you know that most Bible scholars refer to him as the Antichrist? This small horn, the little horn, represents the Antichrist. And so Bible scholars, there's been hundreds and hundreds of books written on the Antichrist and this little horn here. Now, how many of you know that the book of Revelation is the New Testament counterpart to the book of Daniel in the Old Testament? So, let's go real quickly over into the New Testament and look at John's vision. John saw a series of visions, Lord trying to show him the things of the future, gave him a series of visions, and he interpreted these visions. How many of you know the Bible should interpret the Bible? You know the Bible interprets the Bible, and you know what? These visions are not that hard to understand. I mean, the book of Revelation was meant to be understood. It really was. If those who would attempt to study it, they were promised a blessing if they'd attempt to study it and understand it. Not that any of us really understand all of it, but you can certainly understand much of it. John prayed, the Apostle John saw this vision right here, of a 10-horned beast. I don't have time to go into the 7 heads. That would take us another hour. So let's just concentrate this evening on the 10 horns. These 10 horns represent the same thing that basically Daniel had seen in the Old Testament. These 10 horns represent the 10 horns, or as Bible and prophecy scholars will tell you, represents the Antichrist kingdom, the kings, the 10 kings of the Antichrist kingdom. Remember, the little horn came out from among the 10. All right? Now, let's get your Bibles, if you have your Bibles. You want to read along with me. Let's go to the 17th chapter of the book of Revelation, and we'll be reading starting in around verse 12. And you just, let me just say this before we get started. The common interpretation here among Bible scholars about these 10 horns is that, of course, they represent 10 kingdoms. I probably ought to do this before I read this and just make it a little clearer. If you take a survey, a poll, try to find out what most Christians believe, what they've been taught about these 10 horns, you'll find that most believe that these 10 horns represent 10 kingdoms that's going to come out of the geographical area of the old Roman Empire, and that they probably represent 10 kings of these 10 kingdoms. That's what I call the majority view. And that's what most of your Bible scholars teach. And I taught that for a long time myself. Then there is what I call in my book the minority theory or view, and that these 10 horns represent 10 United Nations economic control zones. Those of us who, and it's usually the, I refer to this crowd tonight, you people here, as the Christian patriot group, who have been pretty much thoroughly taught about the United Nations. The Christian patriot group has a pretty good understanding of what the United Nations is trying to impose upon us with their so-called treaties and charters. You see, we, like I said earlier, we're not a constitutional republic anymore. We're a plutocracy, and we're being run today. Now, our country is being run and controlled today by United Nations charters and treaties. Our Constitution is being avoided, you see. So the minority view among the Christian patriot group is these 10 kings here, these 10 horns, represent 10 economic control zones. But I have a third interpretation that I would like to suggest to you tonight. Although I believe that the EC, the common market nations, the old European area, and the common market are all going to play a part in what happens in the end time, there's no doubt about it. Do I believe that the United Nations is going to take a part in this thing? You know I believe that. But I don't necessarily believe these 10 horns represent those 10 economic control zones spoken so much by the United Nations and promoted by them. Okay. With that said, let me go back to my Bible here. Revelation chapter 17, verse 12. I, in my book, or the subtitle of my book, Lucifer's Children, The Kingdomless Kings of the New World Order is my subtitle. Well, why do I say that? I call these kings kingdomless kings. And why do I do that? Because they're not really kings, I don't believe, in the true sense of the word. I believe they're 10 dynastic kingdoms, or 10 powerful family dynasties. And I'll show you why I believe that. Let's read verse 12. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Now let's look at this real closely. I did a Greek study. I went in the Greek trying to understand this kings and kingdoms, and I found out the word there in the Greek for kings here does not necessarily mean a crowned monarchy or monarchist. It actually means an exalted one. It could possibly mean the power behind kingdoms. How many of you know that these powerful dynasties that I've been talking about this evening are the real power behind kingdoms, you see? So just hold on here and see. You know, don't throw stones at me yet. Just hold in here with me a little bit. I know this is a little different interpretation. I'll just read it again. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. It doesn't really say that they're kings, does it? Actually, it said they haven't received a kingdom as yet. And when they do receive what they call a kingdom, it's only 1 hour with the beast. When did the little horn come up? First the 10 came up, and then immediately the little horn popped up from among the 10, right? They received power only 1 hour immediately in a short period of time with the beast being the Antichrist here. So they come on the scene, and then they bring the Antichrist to power, I believe. Now, how does the Antichrist come to power? I'm going to ask you that question again here in a minute. Let's go on and read verse 13. These have one mind and shall give their power and their strength unto the beast. So how does the Antichrist come to power? Does he come to power by his power? Okay. Let's read it again. These have one mind and shall give their power and their strength unto the beast. You know, we hear all these Bible scholars and prophecy scholars talking so much about the beast, the Antichrist, but how many times have you had anybody talk to you about these 10 kings? And yet it says right here plainly, that it's their power. They come together in the power of agreement, and they have chosen to bring this man on the scene. So they unite their power and their authority to bring him on the scene. Am I reading it wrong? I'll read it again. These have one mind and shall give their power and their strength unto the beast. Let's go on to verse 14. These have one mind. Verse 13. These have one mind and shall give their power and their strength unto the beast. Verse 14. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called the chosen and faithful. Now, what's happening here? We don't have any doubt who we're talking about here. We are talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And we see right here in verse 14, these shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. He is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him, that's you and I, folks. How many of you know that we're coming back with the Lord Jesus Christ? No matter what you believe about the rapture, whether you believe in it or whether you don't, it's irrelevant. The Bible plainly states we're coming back with the Lord some point in time. And we're going to be riding on white horses. He's going to be riding on a white horse. We're going to be behind him. And he's going to come back and he's going to destroy the Antichrist, his false prophets, and their armies with the brightness of his coming. And all we're going to do is just be spectators. Amen? Amen? Now, what's going to happen during that time? He's going to come back. His vesture is going to be dipped in blood because, I don't know if you know this, he's going to go over to Syria, Damascus. He's going to go to a lot of places. He's going to destroy whole groups of soldiers, a lot of them what we today call terrorist organizations, before he passes over Petra and before he comes back and before he lands over there on the Mount of Olives. Before he walks down through that eastern gate, he's going to do a whole lot of things that most people don't know he's going to do. And we're just going to be spectators of this whole thing. But who does he fight when he first comes back here? Does he fight the Antichrist? And does it say anything here about the Antichrist and the false prophet and his armies? Well, it does in the other parts of the Bible. Actually, it says that he's going to take the Antichrist and his false prophet, and he's going to take his armies, and he's going to cast them in the lake of fire, not the pit. The pit is where he's going to put Satan for 1,000 years. But he's going to take Antichrist and his armies and the false prophet and put them in what's called the pit, the lake of fire. And that is going to be a place right outside of the city of Jerusalem, a place we today call Gehenna. And every feast of tabernacles, and the city of Jerusalem will rise up. And every feast of tabernacles, all the Gentile nations of the world will have to send emissaries to Jerusalem, to the king, to pay their respects, to pay their homage. And one of the things they'll have to do before those people are allowed to go back to their countries is they'll have to walk back down to that highway, and it's a highway. Israel will be risen up. It'll be up on a mountain, and there'll be what's called the King's Highway. And they'll have to walk up that highway. They'll have to travel up that highway. But before they can leave, one of the things they have to do is they have to go down and go out there to the Valley of Gehenna, and they have to look over into that pit and see the Antichrist and his false prophet and the armies of the Antichrist. But, back to my story here. When Jesus initially comes back, it says right here, and I want to read verse 14 one more time, he makes war with these 10 horns. He makes war with what I believe are these 10 dynastic families. Let me just read it. Verse 14. These 10 horns shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings. So it says plainly right there that he makes war with these 10 kings. Yet very few Bible prophecies, very few books on Bible prophecy, rather, even touches on this thing, see? But it's an absolute fact. And then down here in verse 17, we have one more little verse that I'd like to read that ties into it. 17 says, "For God hath put it in their hearts to fulfill his will and to agree and to give their kingdom unto the beast until the words of God shall be fulfilled." So God has put it in the hearts of these 10 horns, whatever they are, to agree, to come together in the power of agreement, to come together. You can call it a conspiracy. You can call it whatever you want to call it, but it's the power of agreement. And they agree to bring the Antichrist on the scene. I think I pretty much established that in most everybody's mind right here. Really, all you have to do is read your Bible. The Bible interprets the Bible. Well, let me ask you one more question here before we quit. What is really the power that these people all bring together that they hand the Antichrist that actually brings him on the scene? It's the power of money. You ever heard of 666? What is Antichrist? What tool does he have that gives him so much power over all of the world? You cannot buy and you cannot sell without his mark. He controls the buying power of the world. By the time he comes on the scene, there's going to be a total worldwide cashless economy controlled by technology, some of which we don't even have yet today, but it's rapidly being developed. The pieces of the puzzle are coming together as we speak right now. I saw a documentary the other day on some of the new banking technologies and equipment. It's mind-boggling. Some of the things that they can do. How many of you know your money has strips in it right now? And you know, I talked to a guy not too long ago, and he said he had sold a piece of property. And he had closed on this piece of property, and he was driving down the street, out on the highway rather, and a highway patrolman pulled him over. And the highway, you know, he said, "Well, what's wrong, officer?" He said, "Well, you know, you were driving all right." He said, "I just wanted to know what you were doing with all that money." And I forgot exactly what the figure was, but he named it to the dollar. He not only knew that he had all that money on him, he knew how much it was. What keeps them from going down the, just going down the street and clicking on every house and telling how much money's in there? You see? What's possible nowadays is unbelievable. Okay, again, let me ask you a question. What gives the Antichrist his power? He has placed within his hands what I call in this book the central banking conspiracy. He has control of the central banks of the whole world. They have all been created by the Rothschilds, the Warburgs, these groups that I talk about, Rockefellers, Morgans. All these powerful dynasties that I've been talking about have created this no-money, cashless society, and you and I are being ready to be victimized by this thing. We need to be in prayer. So who are these people? Who are the 10 horns? If I understand this whole thing right, the 10 horns represent 10 powerful dynasties that have created this cashless society that we've been talking about here. I don't see how they can be anything else but that, you see. Now, how many kings were there in the lost continent of Atlantis? 10 dynastic kings. Can you see where I'm coming from here? These people, at the beginning of this whole thing, I laid out, showed you right there how that the Plato's concepts were the very foundation that this New World Order has used and the model that it has used right down through time to create this whole thing. This whole cashless society is here today, and if we're not smart, if we're not in prayer, we certainly can be victimized by it. But how about Plato's other concepts? How about the breeding of people? I said it earlier, I touched on it. I firmly believe that we here in America are today right where the Christians were, and in my book I have a chapter, several chapters on Hitler, three actually, one of them titled The Hitler's War on the Church. And in here I document how that certain segments of the church in Germany capitulated to everything that he did and said and wanted to establish. He actually created a church over there. But I also document those few who stood up against what he was trying to establish. And those brave people led their people, and they stood up for what they believed was right. And they called a spade, they called. They said, hey, this guy is, he is satanic. And I firmly believe, folks, we today, right here in America, are right where the German church was about 1936, 38, 39. Why do I say that? Because the same satanic, occultic forces and the same concept that we've discussed here tonight, the same concepts that were ruling the Nazis and Hitler, are the very same concepts and belief systems of the Theosophists and Rosicrucians who today are controlling Washington, D.C. It could very well be that we will come under these same persecutions. I don't know that to be a fact, but I know one thing for sure. Our life needs to be hid in Christ Jesus. People come up to me and ask me all the time, how is it that you can just walk around and expose this stuff, and aren't you scared to get up and say some of the things that you say and that you do? And I say, no, I'm not afraid. I do watch behind my back sometimes. My son came to me not too awful long ago and said, yeah, I'm being followed. So do they know I'm here? Yes, they know I'm out there. They know I'm out and around and about. But do I get afraid? I don't lose any sleep, because I am thoroughly convinced that I am in Christ. And what does that mean? That means that my life is hid in Christ Jesus. Amen? And if you're here tonight and what I've said to you has scared you, well, you need to be where I'm at. I'm in Christ Jesus. Amen? And if your life's in Christ Jesus, you'll be able to sleep at night, because I have given my whole self, my family, my children, I dedicated it all to Jesus. That's a safe place to be. Matter of fact, they ask me, what are you going to do? I don't have any other answers outside of Jesus. I don't have any other answers. Because you see, friends, we're fighting a spiritual battle here. Paul talked about fighting and wailing away and swinging at the air, fighting an enemy that you don't have any concept of who he is and what he is. Friends, we need to fight this thing. Most Christians today are lounging in Christian country clubs. They don't even know they're supposed to be reporting to the front lines of the battlefield. See? So we shouldn't be just swinging and wailing away at the air. We should understand that we have an enemy, and Christ has called us to hold up that banner and to occupy. What does occupy mean? It means take all the land you can and hold all the land you take. Friends, that's what we're called to do today. So I don't have any other answers for you tonight other than you need to be where I am. I'm in Christ Jesus, and if you don't know the Lord this afternoon, you need to turn your life over to Him, and you need to be in Christ Jesus also.
You know, the Bible describes a parable. Jesus said that a good man went out and he sowed good seed into good ground. And he said, someone came to him and said, but sir, didn't you sow good wheat into that ground? He said, but lo, tares are growing up among it. What should we do? Should we go in and pull up those tares? And he said, no. Let both grow together till the harvest. He said, because if you go and try to pull up the tares now, you'll also pull the wheat up with it. He said, let both grow till the harvest. Then we'll gather the tares into bundles, and then we'll bind them and cast them into the fire. And he said, that's a parable of the end time. I really believe that we're very close to those end time days now. And I really think we're very close to the time when Jesus will send his angels forth to gather the tares out of the wheat, bind them in bundles, and cast them into the fire. The tares are the sinners, and I don't want to be in that group. He says, then I'll gather my wheat into the barn. And that's the group I want to be in. That's the group that is going to get protected. And yes, great trouble is coming. There's going to be a lot of people that will lose their heads over the mark of the beast. There's going to be a lot of people that will starve to death rather than taking the mark of the beast. But I also believe that right smack dab in the middle of all of that evil, there is going to be a group of people that do know their God that will do exploits. And they will step out in a power that the devil cannot defeat. They will step out in a power that no one has ever seen before. He says, because I'm going to pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your young men will dream dreams. Your old men will see visions. And I believe that he says, Jesus said, greater things than this shall you do because I go to the Father. Yes, trouble is coming and we know it and we're preparing for it. Mentally, physically, spiritually. But I say this to you, the most important preparation is to make certain that you have Jesus in your heart. Amen? I want to be one of those, yes, I know there's a lot of people want to run to the hills, and God may direct us to do that, and if He does, we'll do it. But I also believe right in the middle of the trouble, there's going to be some on-fire, born-again, spirit-filled, tongue-talking believers that will walk up to some of those people that are near death and says, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give to you. And the power of God is going to flow down their hand and hit those people, and the bones are going to come together and they're going to jump to their feet. Hallelujah. Right smack dab in the middle of the mark of the beast being handed out. Amen. Yes, there's going to be some that are going to be hidden away and protected. How he chooses to do that, I know not. That's his business. But I also think that there's some of you watching this video, you know God has been speaking to your heart to get prepared. However, whatever way, then you let Him speak to you. Some of you have got dreams. Some of you got visions. Some visions you can't explain. Some of them are so scary you don't even talk about to anybody. But you know God is preparing you to be a part of that end time army that is not going to run, but is going to turn around and say, greater is He that is within me than he that is in the world. And we're going to have the power of God. But if we're going to be a part of that end time army, we've got to have the Spirit of God in us. Can I hear an amen? Amen? How do we get that Spirit? First of all, we have to realize that we're all sinners. Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Next thing we have to realize, we cannot earn it. Ephesians 2 verses 8 and 9 says, for all have sinned. I mean, for by grace you are saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. Art, if it's not a gift, or if it is a gift, then how do we reach out and take that gift? Romans 10:9-10 says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth into righteousness, but with the mouth confession is made into salvation. So what do we have to do? We have to believe in our heart, but we have to confess with our mouth that Jesus died on the cross. His blood washes our sins away. We get our name written in the book of life. So we get separated from the wheat and the tares. We become the wheat, not the tares. How do we do that? Confess with our mouth, believe in our heart that Jesus is Lord. Finally, Acts 2:38 says, repent and be baptized. Every one of you, not just a few of you, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, the washing of your sins away, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's just that simple. Now, if you want to be a part of the wheat that's gathered into his barn, if you want to be a part of that end time army that stands up in the face of the devil through the power of God, not through your own power, but through the power of God, then pray that prayer. Let's all pray it. Let's all bow our heads, no one looking around. You may have prayed it before, but let's pray it again. Let's pray it with more intensity and fervor than we've ever prayed it. These are the days we have to pray it right. Dear Heavenly Father, everyone together, dear Heavenly Father, I admit I'm a sinner. And I confess with my mouth, and I believe in my heart, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. He died on the cross. I receive His blood to wash my sins away. I ask You to write my name in the book of life, keep me holy, and save me in the day of trouble. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, sometimes people have prayed that prayer, but they've fallen back into sin. You know, just like the other parable that says, sometimes that wheat fell upon hard ground. Sometimes it fell upon weeds and it came up and it got choked out. Sometimes we got choked out. Our faith got choked out. So sometimes we pray that prayer rededicating ourselves. Maybe we prayed it before, but now we mean it with more sincerity. So if you just prayed that prayer, rededicating your life, saying, I messed up in the past, but from here on out, I'm going to do my best to follow His laws. Would you raise your hand? Okay.